On behalf of the American Sephardi Federation, I'm delighted to welcome you here today for Broken Promises, the Dismantling of the Spanish Law of Return. My name is Sara Koplik, and I'm the director of the Sephardic Heritage Program at the Jewish Federation of New Mexico. We have partnered with the American Sephardi Federation to bring you today's important webinar. Before we start, I have just a few housekeeping issues. Please ask your questions in the Q&A section. We will accept questions in Spanish and English, but are only able to answer them in English today. Please understand that we have a large audience, so we may only be able to answer a portion of the questions. And without further ado, I would like to welcome the Executive Director of the American Sephardic Federation, Jason Guberman, who is working tirelessly to support Sephardic communities across the globe, as you will soon learn. We are profoundly grateful for his support. Thank you.
Thank you, Sara. How can it be that Jews, whose ancestors were cruelly banished from Spain in the late Middle Ages and lived in exile in Muslim and Christian countries, have insisted on preserving a Spanish identity of sorts? This is the question of A.B. Yehoshua, the noted Sephardi Israeli writer who is from a multi-generational Jerusalem family and whose Moroccan and Salonican roots extend back to the Iberian Peninsula. It is as if they had said to those who drove them out, "You succeeded in expelling us physically from Spain, but you will never succeed in expelling Spain from inside of us." Indeed, I'm speaking with you live from the American Sephardi Federation and Association Mimuna's office in Rabat, Morocco, a country in which Sephardim have repeatedly found refuge from Spanish persecution. Already in the 7th century, the Toledan Church's anti-Jewish legislation, coercing conversions and targeting children for abduction, compelled Jews to come here. It was not until the Muslim conquest of Spain that some of these Jewish refugees returned. Over many of the ensuing roughly 800 years, Sephardim created a seriously Jewish yet cosmopolitan Judaism, and in partnership with Muslims and Christians, the Golden Age Convivencia, whose Enlightenment ideal, if inconsistent, reality continues to inspire. After all, Rabbi Moses and Maimonides, the Andalusian Sephardi philosopher and eventually physician at the court of Sultan Saladin in Fustat, was forcibly converted by the Almohads in Spain and escaped Islamist extremism by coming with his family to Morocco, where he was a student at one of the world's oldest Islamic universities, El Karawi'in at Fez. Sephardic Jewish refugees known as Migroshim, or exiles, returned to Morocco again after the Reconquista and have left an indelible mark. From the poetry and songs of Hakatia, the northern Moroccan version of Ladino, to the Lazama synagogue in Marrakesh, Slat Atia in Essaouira, and the Matruz tradition. And not only here. In the ASF's National Sephardic Library and Archives at the Center for Jewish History in New York, we have records of the Halabi Syrian Sephardic Jews who commemorate the Alhambra Decree, or the Edict of Expulsion during Hanukkah, by lighting extra candles. We also have a photo of a member of the Curiel family who was born in Turkey, married in Pakistan, and lived her life in India. We have information on the former chief Sephardic rabbi of Iran, whose lineage dates back to Spain and Portugal. And of course, the music of Gaston Granacia, better known as Enrico Macias, who was a modern day exile from Constantine, Algeria. We also have in our collection, to be specific, in our Lewis N. Levy rare book collection, the works of Menashe ben Israel, a converso or crypto Jew who became a rabbi, founded the first Hebrew press at Amsterdam, was a friend of Rembrandt's, champion of free thought and liberal learning, and as a diplomat, was instrumental in reversing the injustice of England's expulsion of Jews in 1290, roughly 400 years later. Today's event, part of the ASF's Spain Promises campaign, is central to the American Sephardi Federation's mission, both to preserve and perpetuate the history, traditions, and rich mosaic culture of greater Sephardic communities, as well as to represent Sephardic voices in Jewish communal and diplomatic affairs as a member of both the Conference of Presidents of major American Jewish organizations and the World Jewish Congress. We are honored to be joined by many distinguished speakers and over 500 attendees, as well as to present this program in partnership with our good friends and colleagues at the Jewish Federation of New Mexico, who have done such vital work supporting the descendants of Inquisition survivors throughout this process. I'm particularly grateful to Rob Lennick for partnering with us on this program. We are especially grateful and delighted to have with us Congresswoman Teresa Ledger Fernandez, a leader of the Congressional Hispanic Caucus, a 17th generation New Mexican. Representative Fernandez, as approximately 40% of her district, has a heritage rooted in surviving the Inquisition. Following in the formidable footsteps of Doña Gracia Nassi, Congresswoman Fernandez is courageously championing the cause of justice for Sephardic Jews, including those with converso backgrounds. As we marked recently 529 years since the Alhambra Decree, it is easy to forget the insidiously bureaucratic nature of the Spanish Inquisition. The depravity was in the details, not merely discrimination, but denunciations leading to death. There are centuries worth of documents attesting to Spain's relentless persecution of descendants of Inquisition survivors who were tortured and murdered, including at autos de fe, which not always, but infamously featured the public immolation of victims. Passage of the Law of Return was a remarkable gesture after centuries of attempting to eliminate Jews and extinguish the Jewish spirit. The response to the law, it should be noted, was equally extraordinary, as Spain's sincerity in seeking atonement for past sins was taken seriously. Those who had hid from persecution not only started to trust Spain with their vital information, they even looked past the irony of being asked to prove and pay to reclaim what was rightfully theirs. In 2015, on 30 November, a date now synonymous with commemorating the exodus of Jewish refugees from Iraq, Syria, Yemen, Algeria, and other Middle Eastern states in the last century, King Philippe VI gave a speech where he welcomed Sephardic Jews and their descendants back to Spain. He said, "Dear Sephardim, thank you for your loyalty. Thank you for having kept like a precious treasure your language and your customs. They are ours too. Thank you for making love prevail over rancor and for teaching your children to love this country." He continued, "How we've missed you. I want to tell you today that you're back home, your own home forever." These words rang true for 5 years. Over 55,000 people from across the world spent considerable time and thousands of euros fulfilling the rigorous requirements of the application process. Now the warm welcome that King Philippe VI promised has turned into a door slammed shut. The current ruling Spanish Socialist Workers Party, the PSOE, is dismantling the Spanish Sephardic citizenship law 2 years after it officially ended. Descendants of Inquisition survivors are being rejected, visas are being revoked, and thousands more will likely have their applications expire without a formal response. Over 100 people who swore allegiance to the King of Spain have already had their citizenship revoked. This is a matter of life and death for Venezuelan Sephardic refugees who have already purportedly been threatened with deportation. We are very concerned about these changes for applicants across the globe, but also for Spain itself. A law that unanimously passed Congress and worked well for its full tenure is now being destroyed, and all the goodwill generated by the program replaced by a sense of betrayal. This puts into question the role of the notario, essentially a magistrate judge in Spain's legal system. It also must bring into question the extent of anti-Semitism in Spain's ruling PSOE party and its partner Podemos, who are aligned with the anti-Semitic BDS movement, the Khomeiniist regime in Iran, Cuba, and Algeria. Thank you for joining us today, and we hope you will support our efforts to hold the Spanish government accountable to the rule of law and ensure Spain keeps its promises to Sefaradim and Anusim. Thank you.
So at this time, it is my distinct pleasure to welcome another Jewish leader, my boss, the CEO of the Jewish Federation of New Mexico, Rob Lennick, tonight. Please, Rob.
Thank you so much, Dr. Koplik. And thank you, Jason, and the American Sephardi Federation for taking the lead in this very important issue. It has been a privilege. In fact, it's been a calling for the Jewish Federation of New Mexico to help with providing thousands of certificates of Sephardic heritage and to play a role in seeing to it that Spain rights the terrible wrong of the Inquisition by following through with the law of return. A special thanks must be made to our Jewish Federation of New Mexico team, Dr. Sara Koplik, Rabbi Dr. Jordi Gendra, Sara Leiter, Kristen Gruel, and Ali Ezzedine for their tireless work over so many years to advance these aspirations of so many people around the world. Now we are witnessing a new wrong being perpetrated that cannot go unanswered. Promises made and broken cannot be ignored. The Federation of New Mexico cares about the people we've worked with and all the applicants for citizenship very, very much. And we strongly encourage you to take action, to sign the ASF petition, to call your representatives and fight back against your individual refusals by the Spanish government. And most importantly, to know you are not alone. Finally, why is this so important? Why must we come together as a community across the world in defense of these folks, our brethren, seeking acceptance of their Jewish heritage and are simply asking for just and fair follow through by Spain on their citizenship applications? The answer is, in Judaism, we speak of kibbutz galuyot, the ingathering of exiles. It represents an eternal idea that is expressed in Pirkei Avot and the ethics of our ancestors, that to save one life is to save an entire world. There is nothing more noble in this world than to stand up for justice. And that is why we are here today. To our brethren everywhere who are being mistreated in this process, today and every day, we stand with you. We believe in your aspirations. And let me say that again. We deeply believe in your aspirations. And that's why we say, Chazak, Chazak, Venit Chazek. Be strong, as today and going forward, we strengthen one another.
Thank you so much. And now is my distinct honor and privilege to welcome Congresswoman Teresa Ledger Fernandez, who was born and raised in Las Vegas, New Mexico. She attended Yale University and Stanford Law School. After graduating, she returned home to work as an attorney, specializing in community building and tribal advocacy. For 30 years, her law firm has focused on community development, tribal advocacy, civil rights, and social justice. She was sworn into the U.S. House of Representatives on January 3rd, 2021. I want you to know that we are all here at this point today due to the extraordinary leadership and commitment of Congresswoman Teresa Ledger Fernandez. She cares deeply for the converso and Jewish communities of New Mexico, the United States, and across the globe. She is dedicated to preserving the memory of the victims of the Inquisition and supporting their descendants in efforts to receive a modicum of justice for centuries of suffering, terror, and persecution. It is a special honor to welcome her here today. Thank you so much.
Muchísimas gracias. Thank you so much. I really do appreciate being invited to speak here today, and I appreciate the advocacy that each of you are doing on this issue. Anytime there is such a wrong as those who are seeking the citizenship encounter, we must speak out, especially because we did not have the voice to speak out before, right? That we are here today and that this apology was issued because those who fled Spain didn't have the ability to say no. What they had the ability to do was flee. And they have fled like so many other, you know, migrants and refugees fled. They fled for their lives. They fled for their beliefs. They fled for their faith. And I think that, you know, now and these days that we must assist all people who are doing that. Whether it's at our southern border today or across the world. But this apology that Spain issued that we heard so, you know, eloquently described by Mr. Guberman, it was a great thing, right? It was good because it was that acknowledgement of a wrong that must be righted. But what we are seeing now is that it is a wrong upon which injustice is layered yet once again. I am a 17th generation New Mexican, and I know I'm a 17th generation New Mexican precisely because of this law, because I had so many friends and familia and primos and primas espirituales and loved ones who were doing this. I actually began the process and did my genealogy and now can trace such a beautiful history that is fraught with so much complication. I often say, I now know that I am a descendant of the oppressed and the oppressors, of the conquered and the conquerors, right? And of the Carvajals who fled Spain and went through Mexico and came back up to Northern New Mexico because there was no gold here, right? There was no riches. What there was the ability to live and to form and to practice your faith and to mix the faiths. And we all know that in Northern New Mexico. I did a play back when I was in doing teatro, and we did a play precisely about this. And because we all knew that this was part of our heritage, but we didn't know exactly why. And we kind of skirted around the edges of trying to figure it out. But this law prompted so many of us to say, I want to know more. And I want to claim it as part of who I am. For some, it's claiming it and saying, I am now going to practice. For some, it is claiming it and saying, this is who I am. And so part of my complexity is how I'm going to look at the world. But whatever it is, this apology that has now been taken away has to be called out. And so, you know, I am, you know, and will continue to raise this issue, to raise it with my colleagues who are very concerned when they hear about it and are very surprised when they hear about it, and to raise it with the State Department and to raise it with the White House to say, will you please inquire as to why? We cannot dictate what Spain does, but we can ask them to answer some questions. And so that is the role that I will continue to play, is to see if your government here can ask some questions and see if they can be answered. So thank you very much for inviting me. Muchísimas gracias.
Thank you, Congresswoman Ledger Fernandez. And we know that you're pulled in 1,000 different directions. We're very grateful to you for spending time with us here today. Thank you. And now would you like to answer any questions, or are you? Oh, we can't hear you.
Unless there, I kind of need to take off. I didn't know.
Okay, thank you.
Were there some key questions that people had? Or, I mean, I can tell you that's what we're doing. We have, you know, I'm in conversations with the Congressional Hispanic Caucus, who, you know, are being alerted to this and wondering about this. And so we're going to continue. You know, that's a role we can play. We don't, like I said, the United States can't dictate to Spain, but we can ask the questions. And sometimes asking the questions leads to a reflection. It's like, well, what are you doing? What are we doing? And it's not just my district, which I think we just determined that, you know, my district is 40% Hispano, and, you know, not all of them, a lot of them, we have new immigrants, but we probably have the largest, like, Sephardic heritage district in the country, and we're proud of it, right? It has led to a wonderful reclaiming and a wonderful celebration of the heritage, and I think that's really important as we move through the world where religious intolerance is a problem across the world, that we can show that this was about religious tolerance and understanding and celebration. And so what Spain is now doing is undermining that as well. I mean, the layers of what's going wrong is interesting. But I know that many of you are going to be talking about it. So thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for honoring us today. We so appreciate it. And now it's my turn. Now we're going to turn to Genie Milgrom. And unfortunately, Genie has suffered a family loss today, but she still wanted to join us. She was born into a Roman Catholic family of Spanish ancestry in Havana, Cuba, but grew up in Miami. In an unparalleled work of genealogy, she has been able to fully document her unbroken maternal lineage going back as far as 1430 to pre-Inquisition Spain and Portugal, some 22 generations. She has traveled extensively to Fermoselle, her ancient village in the Zamora region of Spain, while doing field research on the medieval Jewish community of the village. She is the past president of the Jewish Genealogical Society of Greater Miami, president of Tarbut Sefarad Fermoselle in Spain, and outgoing president of the Society for Crypto-Judaic Studies. Genie will be sharing stories of those who have contacted her recently, and we're so grateful to you. Thank you, Genie.
Thank you so much. It definitely is not an easy day, but I was not gonna miss this for anything. I think it's very important. I did trace my genealogy. I returned to the Jewish people. I am a survivor of the Inquisition. Even if it took me 623 years to return, I was able to find my roots. I help people around the world and I do not do this for a living. I wanna make that very clear because I wanna make a distinction that my role, as was said earlier, my role, I see it as I have a front seat in the ingathering of exiles. I don't go looking for people, they come looking for me. And when they do, I help them. When the Spanish law was passed, I had hundreds upon hundreds of people contacting me and I guided them. I sent them to the Federation in New Mexico, depending where they lived in the world and where they were. And a large majority of those people that were contacting me were from Venezuela. Obviously, the situation in Venezuela is not good. So if there was ever a time for people to want to make a change in their lives, this was it. And I don't think that a lot of people realize that Venezuela, it's not just casual people. I have a lot of people that have asked me if I think that people are making up lineages. And I have to say, absolutely not. I do this day in and day out. I have the largest collection, which is offered free of charge to anyone in the world on Jewish gen, of genealogies of this. Venezuela had the influx from people from the Jewish community of Curaçao, which was initially the Jewish community of Amsterdam. People from the Jewish community of London went to Jamaica, came to Curaçao, and then to Venezuela. There were people from Suriname going into Venezuela. And so even though there was this influx back and forth, people just don't understand that the Venezuelan Sephardic lineage is probably one of the strongest outside of Mexico. I would say it's probably one of the strongest in the island. So people, I directed them to go to all these places and they did. Genealogies were made. They were sent off. And all of a sudden, a couple of months ago, it was incredible. I think in November, December, people were like, it was as if it was from the beginning. People calling me, crying. People that, one, I will give you just a few examples because I think it's so important. One lady called me via Facebook. I didn't even know you could call via Facebook, but she called me in tears because her citizenship had been revoked. She had already been living in Spain for 2 years. Her children were already in school in Spain for 2 years and they were revoking it. And what is she supposed to do? She's supposed to go back to the craziness that's going back in Venezuela. And now there's another woman when they saw that I was speaking here and they're telling me, basically you have to talk on the moral and ethical part of this because besides the fact that people have spent countless amounts of money gathering genealogies, getting this done, hiring lawyers, trying to work with whoever they could around the world, they have not heard. I have one person, many people on my WhatsApp, but one who told me this morning, he has not heard anything since July 2019 when he presented his papers. I mean, is that even fair? And now, Jason Guberman said at the beginning, there may never be a response. I have another gentleman who waited 9 months in Venezuela to sell his home, 9 months after he presented these papers, fully intending to go back to the home of the original home of the Jewish people, of the banana seam, and he is out of luck. And I have another one here that I'm going to read real quickly, and I'll end with this. And it says, we have complied with every requisite discussed by the law. We have done everything by the law. We have followed every single thing that we have done, the spirit and the letter of the law that was obligatory that Spain requested. And I think that to negate us, to not answer us, it violates the law and causes not only a physical damage that we can obviously, that we can obviously count in dollars and cents, but we can never get back the moral damage that has been done to us. And not only do we have a suffering from the Jewish people here in Venezuela, we're now getting it in our face from our country of ancestral origin. So I will end with that. You should know that there are many, many people in the same situations as I have discussed now. Thank you, Sara.
Thank you, Jeannie. Thank you for sharing with us today in this difficult day for you and your family. And we send you our condolences, and we're so grateful for you and for being an advocate for so many vulnerable people. Thank you for all your good work.
Okay, thank you. Thank
you. And now we are very fortunate to be able to welcome Jason Silva to the webinar. Jason is a Jewish Venezuelan American filmmaker, philosopher, and futurist who uses technology to help people become engaged in the life of the mind, philosophy, and science. He hosted the Emmy-nominated National Geographic series Brain Games, broadcast in over 171 nations. He has also been the host of the global miniseries Origins, The Journey of Humankind. His inspirational videos, Shots of Awe, have received over 100 million views and explore futurism, technology, creativity, the science of awe, disruptive innovation, relationships, and mental health. He will share his personal story as a Venezuelan and the efforts that he has made to try and secure Spanish citizenship for some of his most vulnerable family members. Thank you, Jason. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And a big hello to everyone listening. Si hay venezolanos en la audiencia, también un gran saludo y abrazo para ustedes. To the degree that I can be an amplifier of this message and of this cause, I just really want to extend myself to you guys, because this has become extremely personal for me. So as Sara just said, my nombre es Jason Silva. I was born in Caracas, Venezuela. I am Jewish. I was bar mitzvahed. I lived in Venezuela till I was 18. I was one of the people lucky enough who was able to leave to go study in university. However, my father and my sister were not so lucky. So they stayed in Venezuela, and through my relationship, of course, with them, I have sort of had a firsthand experience of the deterioration in that country. My father has suffered at the hands of the violence there. He's been kidnapped at gunpoint multiple times, has had threats against his life. I mean, the situation in Venezuela is a matter of life and death. I mean, it really is. And so when this situation with the law of return sort of became a thing, and many people that my father knew were doing these genealogical studies, you know, we decided, let's do this, right? Like, I mean, this is this could be a lifeline to move to Spain, you know, for my father. I mean, I just can't tell you the anxiety over these last couple of years with what's happening in Venezuela. And this just became, you know, the North Star, I mean, this possibility. And the irony of this is that, you know, I ended up going on a journey of discovering my own Sephardic ancestry as well, because even though I'm Jewish, on my mother's side, a lot of that ancestry is Ashkenazi, although we have since found out that we also have a Sephardic ancestor on my mother's side. My father is, again, what you could call a converso Sephardi, so he didn't even know this. You know, he was Catholic as far as he knew, although he converted to Judaism when he married my mom in the 70s, but through the studies of the last name and through this genealogical stuff that we were able to find out, we found out that, lo and behold, my father also has a Sephardic lineage. His name is Luis Manuel Silva, and by extension, my sister, Paulina Silva Perez, as well, and my brother, Jordan. And so we went through this process and invested a significant amount of money, I think upwards of $20,000. We worked with the best lawyer that we could find at the time. Thankfully, you folks in New Mexico were so supportive and facilitate us getting the Sephardic certificate. And we did everything that the law said, right? The law says that it is the notaries in Spain that are the ones that are meant to evaluate the documents. And if you secure all of the documents, including the study of the last name, the proof of Judaism, the Sephardic certificate from a federation somewhere, a congregation, I mean, we delivered all of the documents. In my dad's case, he went to the notary to sign before the COVID pandemic, something like February or March 2020, and has heard nothing since then. But the point is, we showed up at the notary. We had all of the documents vetted with our lawyer there, with the notary people there, everything approved, everything fine, right? Everything verified, and you sign, which according to the law, that's it. The role of the Ministry of Justice at that point is just to verify that you don't have a criminal record. So as far as we're concerned, we meet the criteria of the law. We did it by the law. And here we go, you know, a year and a half later, and my father has received no information. And then with the COVID pandemic, the situation in Venezuela, I mean, it's just been absolutely awful. And the frustration on my end is that, you know, I'm trying to use my voice as a public figure and somebody with a tremendous following, para ser la voz de la angustia venezolana. I mean, to the degree that I can, like, Venezuela is un país that opened its arms to Spaniards, right? So many years ago, it was a place that welcomed people from the world, welcomed people from Spain. And so to see what Spain is seemingly doing now is just, it's heartbreaking on every level. You know, and just to give you like an example, I was even interviewed by Radio Sefarad, which is a publication associated with the FSCJE, the Federation of the Jewish in Spain. And even though I was interviewed by their publication, the FSCJE has still not approved the documents that we have sent them to try to subsanar our application to make it stronger, given that we have received no feedback from the government, even though we met the original criteria of the law. So the irony of ironies of what's happening is just so unjust. So in any case, my heart goes out to every single person listening, todo lo que están escuchando. I am an ally in this fight, and estoy a la orden in any way that I can to amplify this message and to right this wrong. The journey for me to connect with this, you know, I already had on my mother's side a family that died in the Holocaust, but through this, through studying this heritage and seeing what happened with the Inquisition and with this Sephardic ancestry of ours, it's just been even more heartbreaking. So I'm here. Think of me as an ally and a voice. And I just want to thank you for the opportunity to share my story, because in the end, I'm just trying to help the people that I love have a better life. And, you know, the situation in Venezuela is a matter of life and death. So let's do this, guys. And thank you for having me.
Thank you so much, Jason. We are just absolutely delighted that you are standing by our side and standing by the sides of the thousands and thousands of Venezuelans who can't speak openly. Yeah. And your voice is so important, and we're profoundly grateful to you. Thank you.
Thank you.
And now it's time for us to turn to Professor Emeritus Don Arnulfo Ramirez, who was knighted by the King of Spain in 1992 for his academic contributions and publications on the use of Spanish in the United States. He held professorial appointments at UCLA, Stanford, SUNY Albany, and Louisiana State University. His daughter, Professor Cristina Miriam Dominguez Ramirez, became Jewish without knowing the full converso history of her family. An active member of the Richmond Jewish community, she serves on the Richmond Human Rights Commission and has worked on issues of diversity, equity, and inclusion in libraries and government services for over a decade. And so first, Don Arnulfo will be speaking, and later, Cristina. Thank you very much.
Well, in 1992, I received an outstanding award, Caballero de la Orden de Isabel la Católica. And apparently my academic work on Spanish, focusing on educational and social issues, was meritorious. The award was significant in many ways, but most of all, ironically, it evoked the persecution and exile of some family members, the conversos who traveled with Luis de Carvajal in 1580, Among some of the passengers were Espinosa, Ramirez, Gonzalez, Garcia. These were some of the early settlers in Nuevo León, the Nuevo Reino de León. And some of them, the crypto Jews, the Judaizantes, who suffered the Mexican Inquisition, included even more names from the family genealogy, six of them to be exact, and some of them were processed by the Inquisition on many, more than one occasion. These included Ramirez, Gonzalez, Espinosa, Treviño, and others. I'm in Segovia now. Así es que saludos de Segovia, España, Sefarad. This Segovia is, to me, a crossroad of many cosmic forces. First of all, was the home of Isabel la Católica. She was crowned Queen of Castile in 1474. The place where Isabella and Fernando lived and ruled the kingdom for many years. The place or location with an extensive Jewish quarter, at one time housing five synagogues. The home of Chief Rabbi Abraham Señor, who also served as chief accountant for the royal treasury of the Catholic kings. And moreover, it was a place I lived for a year teaching at the Teachers College, Escuela Normal Universitaria, back in the 70s. Moving along chronologically, on July the 13th, 2018, my daughter and I completed the application process for Spanish citizenship and was signed before a Spanish notario. The documents completed were submitted back in 2018, and the application included the Sephardic Heritage Certificate from Orbe Shalom in Atlanta, as well as the Jewish Federation of New Mexico. The documents included all the required specified items in the citizenship law of 2015. On June the 9th, 2021, not too long ago, the application was rejected, denegada, by the Ministry of Justice, at least on the website, but there has been no explanation or even an attempt to contact my daughter and I formally regarding the refusal to go on with the next step, that is the process of receiving the Spanish passport. In many ways, I think I continue to personify some of the stereotypic attributes assigned to Jews. I continue wandering on life's journey, facing recognition, discrimination, and even humiliation without retreating and adapting promptly to obstacles on the road. My daughter Christina has her unique story, and she has gone beyond what I have done on the road back to Judaism. Christina.
Okay, muchas gracias, papa. And I hopefully will see you next Friday.
The 13th.
Yeah, Friday the 13th. As Sarah introduced us before, our story is kind of unique in that my father had gotten a large recognition from the Spanish government years ago. And personally, I had been on my path to rediscover and re-embrace my Jewish roots. I started studying Judaism in high school. I worked with a rabbi, a conservative rabbi in Austin, Texas. I converted officially in my early 20s. I am an active member now of the Richmond Jewish community. In fact, I am now participating in the Community Leadership Institute for the Jewish Federation of Richmond. I'm a very happy member of Temple Bethel here And what has been so tragic about all of this is that, you know, for Papa and myself and many others whose lineage comes from Northern Mexico, South Texas, is that our ancestors survived the Inquisition twice in Spain and then in Mexico, only to now have a little bit of an opening and then be turned down again. And so it's pretty devastating emotionally and psychically when, you know, we have done so much, not just for Spain, but in promoting Spanish language and studies, but also reclaiming our heritage. And in my case, I want to feel like a complete person again after all of these centuries, and Spain has said no, and no, again, no explanation, just said the negado. So like I shared with Sara, I feel that at this moment, since there's so many thousands of us going through this same process and same experience, we need to say enough is enough. We've been through the Inquisition once or twice, depending on where you ended up, your ancestors, but we need to be actively writing a new chapter in this history. And this new chapter is gonna include, no, we need to have what was promised to us honored. So that's my story. Thank you.
Thank you both so very much. We're so grateful to you. Thank you for sharing your stories with us today. And our last presenter is Cesar David Siriano Vela, who is a Spanish immigration attorney who has helped hundreds of people apply for citizenship under the Sephardic law of return. He was educated at the University of Zaragoza, where he received a doctorate in administrative law. He's the author of two books, Economic Administration and Discretion, a normative and jurisprudential study, and The Principle of Legality and Economic Intervention. In addition to teaching at the University of Zaragoza's law school, he has practiced public law for 20 years. And we're so glad that you're here today. Welcome, Cesar.
Thanks a lot, Jason and Sara, for the invitation to this conference, Rabbi Hendra and the rest of the participants. It's a honor for me to be here. And first of all, I want to transmit, I'm really ashamed, avergonzado, no, about all what is happening, no, with my government, no, and I want to think only that is a mistake, and it's going to be solved, okay? But many Spanish people, the ones that we consider Jewish, no, but also many others, many thousands, many hundreds of thousands, and even millions, who support the Sephardic people and the Jewish people, no. And so first, I want you to know that many Spanish people is also helping and supporting, no, in all that we are doing, okay. So, first of all, I want to explain now the legal actions that we are making against the all what is happening with the Minister of Justice of Spain in the last months. Okay. First of all, when 30 years ago, when I finished university, I made my PhD about the control of the discretion of government, no? So Hashim God does the things for some reason, no? And after, I had the chance also to study here in this PhD two special questions, no? First, the control of the government, no, by the judges, no, by the courts, the discretionary powers, no? And second one was the principio de legalidad, no? I will tell you now why I'm talking about this, no, now, no? So I spent many thousands of hours when I was young studying all these questions, no? And I didn't know that more than 20 years later, I was here, no? Fortunately, no, all this knowledge that the God, Hashim, permitted me, no, to have, no, at the university, to put there now here this knowledge with my team, no, for helping many people, no? So in government of Spain, as you know, rejected, in about 40,000 cases solved, 2,500, no, in the last 3 or 4 months. But from 2015 until 2020, until 3 months ago, government of Spain approved all the cases, no? They approved almost 30,000 cases, and they only reject 2, no? But since the month of March or April, they started to reject cases, no? They changed the way that they understood the law, no? And many of all the people who have a case with the government was thinking, why this change, no, of the way of understanding the law, no? So nobody is understanding this, no? So I have prepared a big legal report, this dictamen, okay? 2 months ago, I sent to I think many, all of you probably you have, and if some of you, you need it, I can send, okay, by email, and also I can share, because it will be very useful, okay, but that many people start greetings to the government of Spain, legal actions, no, to stop all this, no? The government of Spain, when they rejected the citizenship, they have a very, very big mistake in understanding, in my opinion, one very important point in the law, who is the Article 2 in the law 12-2015, the Ley 12-2015 of Sephardic Spanish Citizenship. The first point is that the notary is the one who has the whole power to declare a person a Sephardic, okay? Because when the Congress made the law 5 years ago, they decided to delegate the competence from the Minister of Justice in the notary, okay? And the notary is the one who is making the judgment, el juicio de notoriedad, who is the judgment about the Sephardic origin of one person, and also they declare also the special link with Spain or the applicants. So the Article 2.3 and 2.4 in the law gives the notary the whole power to declare a person a Sephardic. And they say, Article 2.4, cuando el notario envía el acta, when the notary sends the acta, when the Sephardic comes to Spain to sign, the government has to approve the citizenship, okay? In other laws, they say they can approve or they can reject. But in this article, they say very clearly, the government has to approve the citizenship. So government now cannot review the cases again, okay? Because the law is giving the notaries all the power. Okay, you have more questions now in this time. We can explain more, no? In detail, but it's very, very important this point. So the Ministerio and the Directora General or the Director General cannot now review again the cases, okay? Because the notary is the one who declared everybody as a Sephardic, okay? So everybody has to be approved, okay? Is the conclusion, the first conclusion, because of this. Because when a person comes to Spain to a notary, the government cannot change, okay? So in 150,000 people who started the law, about 100,000, 60%, has still to come to Spain. And we are fighting also for an extension of the deadline to come. I think we are going to get it, no? And I hope, no? Many months more. So I encourage everybody to come to Spain to sign. Okay, because the notary is the one who has the power. Eh? Don't discourage, because many people now is in panic because of these changes, no? No, come to Spain, okay? Because we'll succeed. Eh? It's the first message I wanted to transmit. And the second message is, in the dictamen, in the report, also we studied a very important question, who is that the Ley 12-2015, the 2015 law, in the disposición final cuarta, in the fourth disposition, they established very clearly that the only one who can develop the law is the Ministry of Justice, el Ministro de Justicia, approving órdenes ministeriales and also reales decretos, proposing to the government, okay? He's the only one who can develop the law. But in the last 5 years, there is no orden ministerial, there is no real decreto developing the law, okay? Only the director general and the directora general approve instructions, circulares. And all those instructions are forbidden, because the administrative procedure law in Spain forbids to one person who has the power to develop one law, they forbids to delegate the competence. It's totally forbidden, okay? So the ministry cannot delegate the competence in the director general. Okay, so all the instructions, all the circulares who have been approved are totally illegal from the beginning, okay? Because they go against the law. And the Spanish administrative law is very, very, very guaranteed, okay? It's muy garantista, okay? So it's very, very important that people know this, okay? I'm preparing a small greeting for free for everybody, okay? I'm sending and publishing, or I'm sending to all of you also, to you can send to many thousands of people, and they can send this by email, by post office, by the electronic register to government, okay, to press, to tell them that the notary is the one who has the power and the all instructions are illegal. I hope the government is understanding all this and they are changing totally with all this pressure that all of us we are doing. And they have to change totally. And all the cases has to be approved. All. Only a person who has a criminal background in Spain, who has a big legal problem, something like this, can be rejected. Probably only 0.0001% of the people, but the 99.9% of people have to be approved, because the law is like this, okay? So if we get to cancel and to finish all the instructions, okay, to annular, to become illegal, okay, all the people who have been rejected will be approved automatically, okay? Because the government bases the reason to reject the people in the instructions, not in the law, because the law protects the Sephardic, because there is seven, I'm finishing now, there is seven kinds of proofs for being Sephardic. Okay, first is the rabbi of your city, the rabbi of your country, the Federación de Comunidades de España, also the Ketubah, also the Sephardic traditions, and also other kinds of proofs. In these other kinds of proofs, the notary can use the Jewish Federation of New Mexico, or Beshalom, Med Moshe, and also the rabbi from Australia, the rabbi from South Africa, anyone who is a specialist in Sephardic can declare a people of Sephardic, okay, a person, okay? And if the notary considers that this community is serious, is correct, and the genealogy or the name report, because it's possible, name report, and also the genealogy, both, because the law talks about informe del linaje de los nombres de los apellidos sefardíes, no the genealogy, ojo, and the law is the law is la ley, so the instructions cannot change it, all are illegal, totally, okay? So when the notary declares a person a Sephardic, government has to respect, it is what the Minister of Justice has declared until 1 year ago in many, many resolutions, okay? So all these resolutions obligate the government, and also some thousands of people have been approved with the American communities, without the Federación de España in the last 4 or 5 years, from Latin America, okay? People from Colombia, from Venezuela, from Mexico. So the government cannot change it now, okay? And if the government removes the citizenship to one person, they will have to pay to this person many, many hundreds of thousands of euros, okay? Because law in Spain says that they have to give an indemnización. Okay, because it's clear, okay? Because how is the value of one citizenship for one person, no? For the whole life? No, you work in Spain, you have business in Spain, you study, you make research, there's no value, okay? So government will have to give money, big money to people if they want to remove one citizenship. Okay? It's very clear in the law, okay? So in conclusion, my understanding is that all the people who have been rejected will have to be approved again, okay? And also, all the circulares and instructions will have to be removed also, okay, by government or by the courts. Okay, we are doing this job, helping many people, and by the way, many for free because they don't have enough economical medios. They tell to us, we help because it's our work, okay, in the last 25 years. And in the same time, we are trying to cancel, to become illegal, the instrucciones, okay, by the court. Okay, and this is the final reflection. No? And also, I hope all that, all what is happening about citizenship will be useful for government of Spain to change the law and to let it permanente, no? I think the Spain will need to have a permanent Sephardic citizenship law. We have now with Carta de Naturaleza, and it's possible to apply, and people has a right, and the people must be approved. But I think we need a law similar to the one of 2015, but without notary, without trip to Spain, all by internet, without exams, because many people cannot speak Spanish now, okay? Because it's second generation of Sephardic, third generation, and I think government has to provide this opportunity also to change the law, I think, no? So it's my conclusion, and we will be here to help the people in the process. I encourage you, with all even what is happening is not just, but we'll fight very hard for all the people, no? And thanks a lot for the invitation, and any question now,
Thank you, Dr. Cesar Siriano. We're so grateful to you. Thank you for your wonderful contribution and for explaining Spanish law to all of us today. We have about, I think, 6 minutes for questions. So the first one I wanted to start with is a compilation of many people's questions. And I want to turn that to Jason Guberman. What are the steps that are taken to answer this challenge? Is there a coordinated legal response from Jewish federations, from the Jewish communal agencies in the United States? Can you speak about that for us?
Thank you. There is not a coordinated legal response yet. there is an effort, and we're working very closely with our partners, as I mentioned, the Conference of Presidents, the major American Jewish organizations, the World Jewish Congress, to establish what the facts are, to hear all sides, and then to come up with a plan to remediate this. The ASF has had a wonderful relationship with Spain for many years, and we remember speaking with Spanish diplomats at the time the law was being debated and how excited they were to implement the law. So this situation, which we've been talking about with Dr. Koplik and our colleagues here for many months, has been shocking. We were hopeful. We were giving the benefit of the doubt with the COVID situation. And then when the New York Times article hit, we felt that it was impossible to wait any longer, that this too many people were being affected, and we could not accept the excuses anymore. So now it's all out in the public. I want to thank all of our wonderful speakers, and especially Congresswoman Fernandez for joining us today. She has raised the issue. I saw a few questions about this. I know she has raised the issue with the State Department, with the Biden administration. Some of our friends from the State Department are on the call today. So we're going to continue working outreach with the Spanish government to get clarification and hear their side of the story. And they have a lot of explaining to do, given what we've heard, especially about the situation with Venezuelan applicants.
Thank you so much. We have so much, goodness, we have over 35 questions. I think what we also have another question really about revoking citizenship. And is there any applicable international law? What can individuals do? I think we heard from Dr. Siriano that applicants whose passports are revoked do have some recourse. Dr. Siriano, would you like to answer that question in a little bit more detail?
Yes, of course. Yes, thanks a lot, Sara. About the international law, notice that Spain is part of all the international declarations of human rights, okay? Or the European Human Rights Declaration and also the United Nations Declaration. So everybody, all the citizens from Spain, from America, from all the countries, have the right to go to the institutions, okay, to the European Tribunal. Okay, we will go, okay? If the government is not giving us the reason, we will go to the European Court and also to the International Court, okay, to the one in the United Nations, okay? I think it's a good idea to press also in the international, because notice that the right to return is a human right, okay? It's not only for the Civil War people, now it's a law, no, in the Congress, who is two generations. The Sephardic people is 15 or 20 generations, but it's the same. Eh? It's the same of the memoria historica. It's the same for Sephardic. So it's a human right, and government of Spain has to respect it because it's international law, and it's obligated because Spain has signed, affirmado all the international declarations. It's a good pressure they are going to have if they don't give the citizenship to people, okay?
And lastly, we also have another question coming from Venezuelans. What about those who are rejected for the Sephardi law, but yes, can they appeal and to apply on humanitarian grounds?
Yes.
Is that a way forward for Venezuelan nationals?
Yes, right. Yes, there is two procedures of Spanish Sephardi citizenship. No, one is this one of the Ley 12-2015, who was special only for 4 years, no? The law was not extended, not for the moment, no. And if the government rejects to one person, you can do an appeal in the government, un recurso de alzada, un recurso de reposición. And if in the time of 3 months there is no answer, we can go to court, to contencioso. I advise to everybody who has the appeal in the government after 3 months not to wait, because government sometimes takes 1 or 2 years, no. We have experience in the last 20 years with many citizenship by residencia in Spain. Many cases, and it's better to go to court, because if they take 1 or 2 years, it's a long time, and court is taking about 1 year, and it's not very expensive. No, it's also okay. First thing. And second thing, notice that Spain has, since 1924, the procedure of Carta de Naturaleza. Okay? And we have been researching all these books you see here. It's many degrees of the government, since in the last 80 years, okay, approving many, many thousands of Sephardi people the citizenship, okay? We calculated and about 20,000 people or more have been approved, okay, since 1924, okay? In the years, in the Decreto de Primo de Rivera in 1924, many people, also in the Second World War, were saved the lives from the Nazis, from the German, by the Spanish consuls, no, in Budapest, in Prague, in Paris, no, and all those people was Sephardic, were Sephardic by Carta de Naturaleza. It's the same procedure that we are using now, but with differences, okay? And also with the Franco, in the years 40s and 50s, it was another decreto ley, many thousands from Greece, from Morocco, also from Egypt were approved, from Turkey. And now, Carta de Naturaleza is since 1981, 30 years ago. It's the Article 21 of the Código Civil, and it's possible to apply. The government doesn't want that people apply because they have the mind they have now, you know, no? But people have the right, okay? People think that Portugal is the only way, but not at all, not at all. Spain is there always. The Carta de Naturaleza has never been canceled, never, 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 okay? And it's possible to apply, without exam, without, okay, without trip to Spain, and I advise people, it's another procedure who is there all the time. And people have to approve, because one person who has a brother, Sephardic, who has been approved 2 years ago with the Ley 12-2015, and the other brother or the sister or the father applies now, is Sephardic the same. Government has to approve, okay, with the same proofs, okay? So it's my clear legal opinion, okay, about it, okay? But I wait an extension of the law, okay, also, that they make a law with more articles, permanent for people, and the special circumstances and humanitarian are the same. But I think government, if you apply using this, is the discretionary powers of the government, no? I told you before, no? They can use the discretionary powers and say, no, there is no special circumstances, no? But there are, but they can say, but if you use the other, you press more, okay? Because government has to be pressed by all the many thousands of cases approved before, okay? It's clear, this law is there. They don't, the criminal background in the consulates, they make the same, because this law is there.
Thank you very much. Yes. Thank you, Dr. Siriano. We really appreciate it. We have a lot more questions, but it's already 12 o'clock. I mean, 12 o'clock in New Mexico. It's already been 1 hour. So what I'd like to suggest people do, if they want to reach the Jewish Federation of New Mexico, they can go to spain@jewishnewmexico.org to ask their questions. You can contact the American Sephardi Federation at americansephardi.org. And we're going to keep going. That's the really important thing to do, is to please, for all the applicants out there, please sign the American Sephardi Federation's petition and share the hashtag Spain Promises on Twitter. If you have been denied Spanish citizenship, please don't give up. It is important to appeal the decision, and most lawyers are doing this for free or at a lower cost. Please make your voice heard, because together we can reverse this terrible decision. And I want to thank each and every one of you for joining us today. I hope that this discussion has helped you understand the deep connections between the Jewish community and our converso family members, those who were ripped away from us so long ago. Despite their suffering, we remain very much in their hearts. And now it is our turn to keep them in our hearts, to act on their behalf, and to do what we can to protect their interests today, especially those who are at the greatest risk, those who are most vulnerable in Venezuela.